It's just like when we get to heaven and we're standing before your throne or kneeling before your throne with thousands upon thousands upon thousands of angels and the saints. We're going to be singing, "Holy is the Lamb that was slain, who takes away the sin of the world." And so our worship starts now, and we prepare ourselves for eternity. And we come to you this morning with a spirit and attitude of expectancy that you are going to move, that you are going to reveal, that you are going to transform, Holy Spirit. Because when your word opens, it is a word that divides. It is a word that speaks truth and life into the heart of everyone who has been changed by the gospel to understand it. And so we lift up what you're going to do this morning as we enter into this sermon series on 1 Thessalonians. We pray this in your name. And everybody said, amen. Have a seat. Welcome to church. We are going to get started a little bit differently today. So if you're brand new with us, welcome. We've been praying for you to be here. And we are going to collect information from you that is fairly personal, but we're just doing so because we don't know who goes here anymore. And so one of the ways we're going to combat that is we're going to have an information gathering Sunday. And so congratulations, you just came to information gathering Sunday. And so what you need to do at this time is you need to either look, I'm seeing them down this side. And so on your right side of the aisle, there should be a little tray, and it's got this card on it. And when you have the card, take a pen as well. I'm going to be congruent with my messaging, and I'm going to fill it out, even though I just did it the last service. I might put Pinocchio on mine. I'm not sure because I already filled one out. But we're all going to fill this out together, and you're going to see it says household adults, household children, credit card, retina scanned information. We want to absolutely sell this to creditors. Now, we're not giving this to anyone, but we are adding it to our database because it is our firm belief that there are people going here that we don't know they're going here. So across downtown in here, the four services being held this morning, this is happening. And downtown did this last week as well, and they had a huge return. So not to be better than them, but I want this 100%. So when you have it, raise it up in the air so that I know you are following in line with what I'm asking you to do. So when you have it, show me you have it so I know to get started. All right, that's not a good rate of return. Hold it up. This is going to get awkward. Hold it up. All right, I see some of you that aren't holding it up. Are you ready? All right, so now take this moment, Jeopardy music in the background, fill these cards out. The ushers are going to come collect them with the popcorn-looking buckets in just a bit. So take a minute, let us have your information so that we all know who's a part of New Life this morning, and maybe you've been coming for a year or two, maybe it's your first Sunday, doesn't matter, we're all filling these out together. If you've been here since the first Sunday, I want to hear your pens clicking, because we want to make sure all of our information is updated. So at this time, I know this is a bit awkward. Fill out these cards. Bow, bow, bow. Just kidding. All right, when these cards are done, raise them up so that we can kind of know. Keep the music going. I don't think everyone's done yet. I was writing super fast. Incredibly impressed with myself that I knew all my kids' birthdays, including my bride. Yes, I know. Extra credit. If you don't know that, make one up so it doesn't look like you don't know if you're filling out for your spouse. All right, 15 more seconds. Pastor Chuck, did you fill one out? Thank you. All right, we good? Raise them up if you're done. All right, look at that. And that is how you get people to do something. All right, the ushers are going to come down, and they are going to collect those. Thank you so much for doing that. Every so often, we feel like it's just appropriate to gather information on mass quantity and really force you to do that. I did see my wife not following directive, but that's not because she doesn't listen. That's because I did it, right? And she has her coffee. So everyone else did that. Though, the one thing I want to tell you before we jump into this sermon series is at 2 o'clock, we're getting back together here, and we are providing a service for the community that is also known as Mass Chaos Trunk or Treat. And so if you have your trunk ready, make sure you're ready to roll. And if you want to bring more candy, we will take it. I've seen tons of candy flow through, but we give it all back out. So you can stop back, go to lunch quick, and bring some candy to the event and just participate in that way. But we are excited about this event. This is a massive way that we just love on the community at New Life for Aberdeen. So, all right, here we go. Are we ready? So we are starting a new sermon series today, and it's called Unshaken, and it's faith in uncertain times. And so what I did is I Google searched sermon titles from 1 Thessalonians. I looked at about 50 of them, and I liked two of them, so I just decided to tie them together. That's how creative I was for this title. But really, it is the essence, the reason I like it, of what the book is, the letter is about, but it's also really at the core of where I'm going personally with this and where we're at culturally. And so as we get started, I just want to say something that we typically say when we go through an epistle and we go through a letter to a local church in the early church, specifically if it's Pauline, which most of them are. This is the truth that I want to walk in the next 5 to 6 weeks, that although things are crazy, it's all right because they've always been crazy. Although things are uncertain, although our faith can feel shaken, although politically, I don't know if you guys caught this, but there's an election cycle coming up. Maybe you've heard of it. There's a few candidates. It's a bit controversial. It's maybe some of the reasons that your Thanksgiving meal will be awkward this year. Although we are in a politically charged, chaotic time, we still serve the Savior who's coming back for his bride. And that's what Paul is going to say to this church that he loves dearly. He doesn't kind of love this church. He has a great affection for this church. It's one of the first churches that he's planted. He wants to be with them. There's a backstory why he cannot. I'll get to that in a second. And when he's talking to this church of Thessalonica, he ends the part of the first letter by simply saying, just so you know, I know it's crazy, but Jesus is not just someone that you go to when you die. If you don't die, he could be coming back any minute now. Now, who knows the hour of the day? None of us. But Jesus, get ready. People get ready. In the 90s, there was this song when I was in Bible college. People get ready. Jesus is coming to take you home, right? That the Jesus Christ is coming back for his bride. And if you're new to Christianity, we are the bride of Christ. We are a precious commodity to him. He has purchased us, saved us, transformed us, put us on mission, and we have a role. And we're going to get to all of that in this sermon series, and we're going to go verse by verse. And so here we go. Open your Bibles. You can get on your phone. You can look on the screen. You can bring the physical Bible you brought to church. Open it up. Towards the end of the entirety of Scripture is this short letter, 1 Thessalonians. Paul probably would have written this letter about 48 AD, very early in the ministry. You find a cross-reference to the church being planted in Acts 17. You can go read that on your own time. But here we are in this letter, and he sets up the leadership team before he breaks down what he wants to say in chapter 1. But he always starts kind of like this. He says, Paul, Silvanus, and Timothy, which also can be known as Silas, to the church of the Thessalonians and God the Father and our Lord Jesus Christ. And so the first idea that we're going to walk in is, what is the church of Thessalonica? How does it look like us? How does it differ from us? And so as we walk into this, you need to know this, Paul loved this church. And when he loved this church, he immediately forms a leadership team. And here's kind of what it looked like. The three guys at the top, but those aren't the guys that are actually with them. And when they go there, they set up a group of men as leaders known as elders. And that's why we do that at New Life. So you have Paul, singular leader. You have the other two men that he's walking with Timothy and Silas, plurality of leadership. And then you have another layer of plurality of leadership with the elders that then get established in every local church. That's exactly how we run at New Life. So when you come to church, maybe you have a background where everything is voted on, color of the carpet, you know, I mean, just name the item. Everyone has a plurality of leadership where everyone's in a sense equal. Or maybe you come from a background where what the pastor says goes. And I would present to you as we start that neither of those are biblical models. So the way we run our team is I'm the head vision caster, but it's a plurality of leaders that make decisions. And so I heard it said this week, and I want to bring this up before we move forward. I think it's important that you kind of know what you belong to. That if you have one singular leader, what you end up having as a result is a dictatorship. But if you have all plurality throughout the whole church of leadership, is what you end up having is anarchy and chaos. And so you try to then combine those two ideas and look to the early church as they established elders and plurality, but they also had vision casting, and not everyone sitting in the seat was voting. And so when we have issues at New Life, we go to the elders, we talk to them, we pray with them. I bring them before you before we vote on them, and we're going about to do that probably right after Christmas again, maybe a couple of times, because we always want to have people being onboarded so there's not one person making all the decisions. And so Paul lays that out with the leadership team that's established. And so as the leadership team's established, here's what it kind of would have looked like. This would have been a family gathering. The church, actually in the Greek, translates family. The church is precious in God's sight. It's assembly or gathering. It's like a family meeting. And it would have been so much like a family that it would have met in a home. It would have been a small group of people. And so in the midst of the chaos around them, the cultural norms of the day were absolutely chaotic. In the midst of the temples where gods of sexual desire were being worshipped, and goddesses or Diana or gods like Zeus, name the person. We'll get into this a little bit. In the midst of all of this idol worship around them, you see now the church thinking different, acting different, living different, affecting cultural change throughout the entire fabric of the Greek and Roman world and the Jewish world around them, where this was a melting pot that they lived in. This would have been an area in Thessalonica where it would have had wealth. It would have been a porting city. It would have had influence. People came to visit. They didn't stay long. They went. They sold. They picked up items for selling. This was a hub of influence. And in the hub of influence, there was idol worship all around them. And now Paul walks onto the scene. The church is gathered. The church is formed. Acts 17, he takes to task the ideas of the day. He starts preaching the gospel, and people get saved. And so now they're having a family gathering. And in the family gathering, one of the church leaders would have gotten up in the house and simply read what Paul wrote. And the good news is this letter is incredibly encouraging. He loved this church. The church doesn't have a place, doesn't just have a place. The church also has a role. And so as we start this series off, I want to define roles. What does it mean for the church to be the church? So in Scripture, there are kind of these four entities that exist. There is heaven, hell, and that's the bad news. There's the world, which is not just a people that live in something or, you know, biologically, you know, trees, plants, flowers. It's not, you know, Mother Nature. It's the world as an idea system, which stands in opposition to the gospel. You have heaven, you have hell, you have the world. And then in that, as a minority group, you have the church. And what Jesus comes along and says is, he says, I'm going to build my church, and even the gates of hell, even though it's the minority, aren't going to prevail against it. This is why this is so important that we're all here gathering and worshiping. This is the entity. There is no para ministry. There is no plan B for Jesus Christ. This is the plan to make disciples to the end of the earth. If the church is not something you belong to, if the church is not something that you love, then you are way off with your theology and your heart, because this, all regardless of how dysfunctional some of us can be, is the mode and model that's unchanging for the nations to be reached with the gospel. And so the church's role is to take heaven, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven, to take the culture of heaven and bring it down to earth. That's what we're trying to do, and that's what the Holy Spirit does through us. And so that means that we think differently, we act differently, we're not a part of culture, but we're countercultural. That means that we take stances that aren't very popular, we get mocked at every turn, our influence is attacked, because our objective is in direct contradiction to the prince of this world, which is Satan. And so the church's role is to live for the kingdom of God and take the culture of heaven and bring it down. And then the enemy's role is to take the culture of hell and lift it up. And the way that he does that is he uses this umbrella statement as the world. And so when we look at the chaotic reality of life, just know this, we are at war. This will not change until what Paul says, Jesus comes back. And the misinformation that we gather historically is that somehow in 2024, in the United States of America, that it's worse as it's ever been. No, it's maybe some ways worse than it's been in the last 30 to 50 years. But once you get the backstory of Thessalonica and Ephesus and other places like it, you realize that things used to be actually a lot worse than they are now. And so we don't have to fear because Jesus is still on the throne. Now, we don't disengage from the countercultural battles that we fight, but we don't also then shrug our shoulders and just are crippled by fear because Jesus is still on the throne. And so you have the world's role, you have the church's role, you have the battle ensuing, and our job specifically, write it down if you don't know, this is what we're trying to do as Christians. Our job is to love the people in the world, but we don't love the system of the world. And what we never do is cater to the ideas that stand in direct opposition to the Word of God, because the way that it works, and I want you to get a mental picture, the way that it practically plays out is you have the church and you have the world, and then in the middle of those two things stands the Word of God that divides. And so everything that we think, believe, and feel ultimately is dictated by God's Word in our life. And so when you have beliefs that don't line up with what Jesus says, Jesus doesn't change his beliefs or change his word for the last 2,000 years, specifically New Testament, to cater to your whims because you are not the one who's to be worshiped. He is. And when you feel something that lines up with the word of God, praise God, that lines up. When it doesn't, then it doesn't matter. We position ourselves to belong to Christ and change for Christ, and the word of God does that for us. And so that's what it looks like to live counterculturally. Here's another example as we're getting started. When you walk into this place, you probably first walk in and you're like, oh, it's relaxed. There's open spaces. Then the worship service starts. It's very relaxed. It's not real complicated. It's not stand up, sit down too much. There's a few people that are worshiping where maybe you haven't experienced that and you think they're a little weird, but you get over it. And then you hear from a guy, maybe it's myself most likely, but someone else as well. And the word of God starts being preached, and when you're not saved, it's uncomfortable because now you're hearing things that you're not lining up with your worldview. And it's not the intent of myself. I'm not controversial in my nature. I'm a people pleaser, but I'm also not going to bow to the whims of a shifting culture. I have to be countercultural, and I have to love you enough to tell you the truth that your morality is defined by Jesus Christ, that the exclusivity of the gospel is something that he demands. His affections won't be divided. His truth is unchanging. His ways are perfect. And he is the only one that sits on the throne. He's the only savior that rose from death. Buddha didn't do it. Joseph Smith didn't do it. Muhammad didn't do it. He's the only means in which you can be saved. And so we start saying stuff like that. And maybe you have a worldview that doesn't align with that. And so you feel uncomfortable. But what I would challenge you with before you dismiss it is to look at scripture and say, do I want to submit to Christ and repent of sin, or do I want to be my own personal Lord and Savior? And I'm going to go further with that before we go any further. If that's your mentality, then I challenge you with this ideal. Haven't you been doing that for the last 20, 30, 40, 50 years? And my question for you is this, how's that working for you? If Jesus isn't in charge, then you are, and you make a terrible Savior. And so it's divisive. It's countercultural, and it can be very uncomfortable, but the reality and the challenge is this, that we shift to Jesus. Jesus doesn't shift to our ideals, and praise God, because we're the ones that are broken. And so when you come here, I don't want you to feel uncomfortable by virtue of just being awkward and how, you know, maybe I'm socially awkward. I just want you to be uncomfortable if you're struggling with God to turn to his son Jesus. And then I want you to do that because that's what Jesus wants for you. And I want to see your life transformed and I want to see you saved. And so this is what's taking place when Thessalonica is developed. And I tell you all of that to tell you this. this is how it worked then, and this is how it works now. So the church is formed around 48 AD, historians believe. Acts 17 lays out the story. Paul shows up in the town, port city, preaching with authority. He proclaims the word of God. He doesn't suggest the word of God. He doesn't apologize for the word of God. He just clearly says Jesus is the only way. Jesus is the Messiah. You can read what exactly kind of the dialogue for yourself. And in doing so, two things happen. Some people get saved and other people get angry. He's just spitting truth. He's not like a TED talk, if you're a millennial, where he's just saying, you know, it could be like this. And research kind of suggests that. He's saying, no, this is truth. This is lies. This is Jesus. I was a Pharisee. I was a chief of sinners. I was a religious man of my day in Judaism. He literally knocked me off my horse and blinded me, revealed himself to me. He is the Son of God. And some people hear that and they go, praise God, and they get saved. And other people hear it in Acts chapter 17, and they start revolting. The government structure of the day starts revolting. Jews of this day start revolting. And so the Romans, the Greeks, and the Jews have this thing in common. They all hate the message when they don't turn to Jesus. And people start threatening Paul, and it gets to the point where he knows he has to leave. And here's the spiritual battle that's taking place in the text. Every time God moves, the devil gets angry and responds. That's the principle. And so when we start saying things that are true, the devil's going to have a response and he's going to attack. In fact, more specifically, every time we attack a stronghold in the enemy's camp, culturally, philosophically, when we say we're going to claim this space as a church. One of the things you're going to hear about in Kingdom Builders is Christian counseling options in town that are forming. We're going to claim this space that the enemy has meant to deceive people with, and we're going to endorse it, and we're going to get behind it. And that's just a random example. Or anytime we get onto a college campus where the Bible isn't being proclaimed and we start having influence with leaders and students, you can rest assured every move you make in the chess game of life, there's a counterpoint, there's a checkmate, there's somebody on the other end of the board that's trying to attack. And that's exactly what happens to Paul, because he moves into this culture. He proclaims the word of God. Revival happens. Satan brings a riot. There's a mob that's formed. And Paul decides it's in the best interest of the church for him to take a break and write a letter. That's what's taking place. And so this whole idea of Paul's influence being minimized is also nothing new. It's what we would call today is maybe something like cancel culture. The demonic spirit that stands up against the church to try to minimize the influence. But Paul doesn't back down. It's his best attribute. He's a little Jewish man, the history tells us, with a bald head and huge eyebrows. He has like a unibrow, church historians have said about him. We don't know for sure, but he packs a mean punch, and he's one of the best defense attorneys for the faith of all time. He's the greatest theologian besides Jesus himself, and he's just simply a truth teller. And so he starts telling the truth and paying the price, and he leaves and writes a letter. And this is what his letter says, verse 2. He says, we give thanks to God always for all of you, constantly mentioning your prayers, remembering before our God and Father your work of faith and labor of love and steadfastness of hope in our Lord Jesus Christ. And then what he's going to do is he's going to start laying out the church's identity. And so I'm going to read the identity to you, because he loves this church and they are an example to all of us. Here's what he says about them. He says, for we know, brothers, here's the identity, ready? Loved by God, that's our identity in Christ, that he has chosen you, we're chosen in Christ, that's our identity in Christ, because our gospel came to you not only in word, and so leaning on the word is our identity in Christ, but also in power of the Holy Spirit. And so we have power as a transformational reality of being in Jesus Christ. These are our identifying marks, our power in the Holy Spirit and with full conviction. You know what kind of men we proved to be among you for your sake. He's saying, you know what we were about before we had to leave. And now we know, he's going to lay out, what you're all about, and we're proud of you. But I want to outline as we get started these identifiers that mark us as Christians. This is what happens theologically, supernaturally, and then the overflow of that is where we'll go from here. So number one, when you are receiving Christ, you're no longer an enemy of the gospel like Paul was, but now you're loved by God, you're adopted by God. That the miracle of the gospel is not that you choose to love God, but that he actually chose to love you. He makes this kind of theologically divisive statement. In fact, Ben Stewart on Right Now Media breaks down all of these points, and I got some of this from Right Now Media, which I'd highly encourage you to check out for yourself. He says that when you are in Christ, you're loved by God. You know that you're loved by God because you're chosen by God. And this is something that Paul talks about quite a bit. Ephesians 2, 1 through 5, here's the paraphrase reality of these verses. He says, you were dead in your sins, following the course of the world, following Satan, passions of the flesh, children of wrath, but God, rich in mercy because he loved us, saved us. Or maybe you go back to Deuteronomy chapter 7, verses 7 through 8. He says, you were chosen not because you were more in number than others, but because the Lord loves you. And so this invitation to you this morning to come to Christ is a reality that he has set you apart to hear a message. And now you have a choice to make as to either respond to the message or reject it. And this is a supernatural reality in your life. And here's how it plays out practically. That you could hear this and turn a deaf ear to it, and I don't really know why, because we're all hearing the same thing. That you could hear this and go, what time do the Vikings play? That you can hear Christ crucified and simply say, you know what? Man, I just want to go home and chill out. I'm tired of my spouse dragging me to church. This is a bunch of meaningless nonsense. I wish he would hurry up. Or you can be like so many others, which is why the church has grown, hear the gospel, respond to it, and see things multiply in your life as you were walking in death and now you're walking in life. And so he says, your identity is you're loved, you're chosen. Here's another reality from Galatians, that you're adopted. And he alludes to it in these verses when he says, brothers, this is the family of God. So at this church, we take moral stances and we try to stay out of politics. And so when you hear me take moral stances that sound a little political, know that it's a moral stance and not me trying to dive into politics. But we all know that, in case, you know, maybe we have been blinding our eyes, that there are political realities of the day that are divisive, and it's election cycle. And so you hear things like, well, how are you going to vote? And it's not my job to lay out, you know, the perfect candidate for you. But I will say this, like there are things that are moral, like the sanctity of life. And we have the choice to vote. You know, I mean, this is America, but the reason we hold the positions of sanctity of life is not because of a political affiliation, but because Jesus is all about life-giving, and we know that God is the one that creates. But let me say this, is it just something to add to that, that when you take a position of the sanctity of life, don't stop there. Because understand the theological undertones of once conception happens and once birth happens, we don't just get on board with the sanctity of life. We get on board with things like foster care. We get on board with things like adoption. Some of you have adopted. That is such a biblical thing to its very core. Because we want to live like Jesus. And so you see that as they are showing their identity in Christ, their brothers and sisters in Christ, and they're adopted by God. Galatians 4, God sent his son to redeem those under the law that we might receive adoption to sonship. That's all of us. And so I was dead in my sins. I was 19 years old. I was at a Bible college in Texas before I moved to North Dakota. I had heard the gospel so many times, and it just meant very little to me. And I was doing whatever I wanted with whoever I wanted. I was not serving the Lord. And Jesus just rocked my world. And then I understand when he opened my eyes to my salvation, that although I still wasn't perfect, I was saved, and he adopted me and grafted me into his family. And so it's this idea, like the most beautiful thing in parenting isn't just biological birth, but maybe lens of like a stepdad in your life where he fell in love with your mom, and there's country songs about this. And then when he fell in love with your mom, he said, you know what? I'm going to choose to adopt this child into the family, and I'm going to be like a parent to him or her, even though we had no connection before. So spiritually, we were opposed to God, enemies of the gospel, enemy to God, and now he's opened our eyes, we've responded in our choice back, and now as a result of that, we are grafted into the family, and as a result of that, then he talks about now you're transformed by the gospel. I heard someone say about Paul this week, he only had two options. You either heard what Paul said and he got a one-star review on Amazon, or you heard what Paul said and he was your man. He was a five-star review. That's how controversial this figure was. You didn't have any room in the middle. You either loved him or you hated him. And you know that you're transformed by the gospel. And here's the indicator, so write them down. Because the gospel has come into your life with power. He says the gospel has come into your life with conviction. And the gospel has come into your life in a way that has changed you from the inside out.
let's get just super practical. Yesterday morning, I'm at a men's breakfast. There's like, it seemed like there was 150 guys there. I don't know. That has to be close. And for 2 hours, we listened to testimonies. I kind of walked away that maybe we could have done that an hour, but the testimonies were so good, it worked. And we heard from a guy that was an elder in our church, and actually once an elder, always an elder, but sabbatical, praying he comes back. Wife says, no, we're good. We traveled to Florida in the winters. But his name's Bob, and you might know him because before he retired, he drilled your teeth. Anyone go to Bob Sanders? So Bob has drilled my teeth before he retired, did a pretty good job. I still have my teeth, so it's going well. But he became one of my mentors and someone I look up to in life. And so Kelly Brennan said, come share your story. And I hadn't heard all of it. And he goes way back in the vault, and he starts telling all the men at this breakfast. My son's there, and we're all listening. He says, when I was a kid, I grew up religious. There was this thing that God was doing in my life that I didn't understand because I was scared to die, but I didn't understand how it worked. And then I got involved when I got married in a church that told me, you don't have to be scared to die. Just do this religious ritual and you'll never go to hell. I just performed this act. And so he said, I wasn't saved. And so I just took comfort in that. But my heart wasn't transformed. I had never said, Jesus, take control of my life. I'd never been born again. And so then I got married really young. And I'm probably butchering the story, but I'm paraphrasing it. And I got drafted in the military, but I ended up in Hawaii as a police officer for the military. And we started having children. And then I decided I needed to do something with my life. So I came back home on a GI Bill, and I got a degree in biology. And after I was done with that, I got into dental school at Creighton. And then everything seemed like it should be going just the way I thought. But I came home, and my practice was a wreck. I thought I'd have all these people just coming to see me as a dentist, and that's not the way it went. And interest rates were high, and it was scary. And I was coming home from work, sitting on the recliner, drinking a beer, and my wife, Fern, said, what is wrong with you? We have what we are supposed to have in life, but I was miserable, and I was empty, and then I went to a gas station in this building when it was the Gibson building, and a guy from my past shared the gospel with me, and over a period of time, I was radically saved. And then he starts telling stories about how God used his dental practice for his glory. And he says, I started praying for people that were my clients, my patients. I saw God heal people. I saw God save people. I partnered with a guy who loved Jesus, Dr. Harvey, and we ended up expanding. And he's telling all these stories, and it's giving us goosebumps. It's taking a while, but we're all attending to what he says because he's our elder. And he says, the gospel came in power. I was convicted of my sin. And the evidence of all of that, here's why I bring it up, is it changed my life and my heart. Bob's a crier, so Bob's crying. And Kevin Rao gets up after him, if you know him, and he gets emotional about what Jesus has done in his life. Grown, successful, intelligent, disciplined, godly men weeping like babies. Because Jesus transforms. And so before we go any further, hear me say this. Christianity is not a religious ritual or hoop that you walk through to somehow check the boxes so you don't go to hell. Christianity is you meet Jesus, he grabs your heart and transforms it. You're born again, not because of what you did, but because of what he's already done. He already was wooing you before you ever knew him. And you're sitting here in this space, and I want you to be evaluating things through that lens. But here's how he closes out the verses. Because now he's going to say this to him. We see you. Have you ever had anyone say that to you? Like maybe you're good at a sport, or maybe you've been killing it in your job, and it feels frustrating because you're not being recognized, which is a major reason people leave a place of employment. They don't like their boss. But Paul is sensitive to that. He's saying, we're not with you, but everyone sees you. Last verses, he says, you became imitators of us. This is what people see. And of the Lord, and that's the more important part. For you received the word in much affliction with the joy of the Holy Spirit, so that you became an example to all believers in Macedonia and Achaia. For not only has the word of the Lord sounded forth from you in Macedonia and Achaia, but your faith in God has gone forth everywhere, check this out, so that we need not say anything. People already know. People have seen the difference. For they themselves report concerning us the kind of reception we had among you and how you turned to God from idols to serve the living and true God and wait for his Son from heaven, whom he raised from the dead, Jesus who delivers us from the wrath to come. There's a lot there, but the idea is this. What is the example of new life? What do we do in the midst of chaos? How do we hold together as the tenant of our faith, the Holy Spirit at work? How do we hold together with this strength that's supernatural so that when the chaos happens around us, it doesn't affect what's taking place inside of us? How can we be imitators to calm the nerves and win people over for Christ? What is the church's example? Here's the first idea. It's imitating Christ. Last week, we talked about from Psalm 23 that when David is, in a way, prophesying about the Messiah to come, about being a disciple, he's laying out this relationship he has with God. And he says, my enemies are all around me. Who are enemies? That's the world. That's the narrative. That's the noise that is outside of Christ. The people that we love, but the behavior that we despise. He says, my enemies are all around me, but what does he say? You prepare a table before me. And so we put this word picture in our minds of all the noise and all the chatter and all the people that are lost because we're the minority. And then Jesus in his love for us sits down with us at the table. And what I told you last week was from Giglio's book that our choice is who we put at the table and drown out the noise with. And we can either put Satan at the seat at the table or Jesus. That's the choice that we have every single day. But when we put Jesus at the table, now it's like, you know, hey, pass the orange juice, pass the bacon. We're having fellowship. We're intimate with God. We're communicating with God. And now we live differently. We think differently. Some of you, after November 4th, are going to have frenemies, right? It's already getting tumultuous. Or then by the time you get to Thanksgiving with your family that's not saved, all hell can break loose. Things get crazy because they're not at the table with Jesus. And as things are getting crazy, here's what's so cool. This is what Paul's saying. He's saying, you're imitators of me. Follow me as I follow Jesus. But you're imitators of Jesus. And now you're sitting at the table. And make no mistake, look at me when I tell you this. Everyone who's broken, although they're upset, is watching you feast at the table. And they might not want to talk about it yet, but they see a marriage that looks different than theirs. They see a peace that passes understanding that they don't have. They see the affections that you have for Christ that they don't understand, and they're watching outside of the table, and they're watching you, and they're watching your relationship with Jesus, and it might be the coworker who doesn't come to you until their marriage is a wreck, or their finances are a wreck, or their relationships on the peripheral are a wreck, or they can't stand the boss because the boss is someone who lacks respect, but you still are obedient in your workplace. And they are going to come to you when they need answers at the core level of their life because you're imitating Christ and you're sitting at the table and they know that you have something that they don't have. And then you come to this space to get fed, but it's just an overflow of your spiritual life. It's not something that is the end all be all because you're feeding yourself reading God's word every single day. He says, be imitators of me, be imitators of Christ. He says, this is their identifier. You received God's word. I heard someone give an illustration about a boat, a sailboat this week. I want to share with you real quick. And I completely butchered it first service. He said, there's two components to a sailboat that need to be there to thrive. You have a rudder, but what I did is I said udder. Right? Turns out that's for milking, okay? I said, you have to have an udder because I heard someone else tell this story. And you have to have a sail. And he said, those are the two key components for you going in the right direction with power. Because you can have an udder, not rudder, right? You can have an udder and it can turn you all the directions you need to go because it's the truth that's dictating these turns in your life. But if you don't have the power, you have the directional influence without the wind, without the sail. And so he says, the directional influence in your life is the rudder, and it's the word of God that dictates what's true. And it's an example to everyone else, but then you need the Holy Spirit power in your life to actually engage so that the wind goes to the sail and the direction set through Scripture, and then you're taking off where God would send you. And the cool part is God uses the Holy Spirit to give you the power, and then he directs you to the word to get the truth, and these two things sync up, and everyone else around you outside of the table is watching. But when you live in hypocrisy and you live in disobedience, you can get emotional and want the Holy Spirit, but you don't have the truth. And when you get religious, you just want to memorize more verses, but you don't have the Spirit that actually engages you to have a life that's changed, that's setting you on a path. So he says, be imitators of me. The power of the Holy Spirit is on you. You have obeyed the word. And then the evidence of their growth is that they grew, not in the good times, but they grew in this thing called affliction. Affliction is something that none of us want, but all of us have. And affliction is something not that you get rid of when you become a Christian, but it actually multiplies. Because of what we just talked about with the enemy, when he sees success and territory being gained, he comes like a prowling lion. And so Paul says, you've been afflicted. And it's a central part of the Christian life. He says, affliction is so central that I have a thorn in my own flesh. Affliction is so central to my own life that ultimately he gets beheaded. Affliction is so central to your life because the one that you love and you serve and you worship is also the man of sorrows that the Bible defines in Hebrews and other texts. That Jesus in his affliction, sweat drops of blood going to the cross, nails in his hands, nails in his feet, taking on the full wrath of God for the sin of man. And so the goal is not to be absent from affliction, but to be taught how to walk through it. Now here's what's so awesome. That when you get into the book of Hebrews and it talks about Jesus and his sorrows, it says that as he went to the cross to endure it, he counted it joy. And so the way that everyone else outside of the table knows that you're living with affliction that's supernatural and that is something that you're different than them is the affliction is oftentimes greater, but the way that you work through it is totally transformative and different, and only the Holy Spirit can do it. Because when your life is crap, sorry, to the nth degree, won't use that word again, is that bad? But when your life stinks and you're dealing with affliction, you only have two choices. You have the supernatural reality of the Holy Spirit, which is joy. And you have the earthly reality that everyone else walks in, which is crippling fear. So from a counseling perspective, it's kind of broken down like this. Everyone deals with fear, and that's why anxiety is on the rise about 50% in the last 15 years clinically. And when people deal with anxiety, really what they're dealing with is a fear that hasn't been uprooted in their life. And the reason they're dealing with fear is because you only get two choices. You can turn to joy or you can turn to fear. And here's kind of the clinical idea is that you're either regulated from an organic standpoint mentally, or you're dysregulated. And when you are crippled by fear, you're dysregulated. And when you choose to walk in joy, you're regulated. And so the world is watching, and these people who are dealing with false idols all around them have these two choices. And he's saying, you're dealing with affliction, but you're not living in fear like the rest of the world. Here's what's so scary about fear. It's not just an emotion. The Bible identifies it as a spirit. Paul's talking to Timothy. And when he's talking to someone that he's mentoring, he says this. He says, God didn't give you a spirit of fear, which is the spirit, but he's actually given you a spirit that has allowed you, not of fear, but of power, of peace, of love, and self-control. And so when you have these things that you're scared of, like anyone would be, it's not that they're not scary. Look at me when I tell you this. It's that you don't have to be afraid, even when there's something to be afraid of, because greater is he who is in me than he who is in the world. And that's the contrasting difference that gets put on display. That's the healing power of the gospel. It's not that things aren't scary. It's just that you don't have to be scared because you have something that overcomes. And it's only a matter of time between yourself and others that distinguishes that difference when people see that, and now the gospel is put on display. You live with the power of the Holy Spirit that allows you to overcome the fear of affliction. It brings this joy that's supernatural. And before he closes, he says this, I applaud you. Because in Thessalonica, it was dark. And these guys had been trained to worship things that brought pleasure.
There was a goddess of sex. There was a god of money. There was a god of power. There was a god of pleasure. And so basically, they would create these fictitious gods that they would worship that would then satisfy every carnal instinct they had. Because everyone worships, it's not if, it's just what. And he says, you had all of those things, but now that you're saved, you worship Jesus. And I applaud you for that. And so now that you worship Jesus, it's the cup that doesn't run dry. It's the living water that never allows you to be thirsty when you keep drinking the living water. And now everyone's watching. And so as we close out this week and we look to the joy that we have in Christ and the example that's expected, we turn from idols. And the way that we do that is so simple. And I need everyone to pay attention. It's so simple. When everyone else come next week is freaking out, I'm not saying abandon ship. We live in a free country where we exercise our rights. But no matter outcomes, when everyone else is freaking out, look at me when I do this, everyone else is doing what? Peripheral. They are looking around, and what he says is, this is what you do. You don't look around, you just move up your eyes and you wait for Jesus to come back. You don't disengage from culture, you're countercultural. But in the midst of the struggle, you find the joy, you have the power, and you wait for your Savior. Because you don't have something to fear even when life is scary. You can have the story like Bob Sanders or Kevin Rao. You can walk in the affliction and the struggle, but you can have the joy. Let's pray. Jesus, we love you. We wait for you. We know that you're coming back. We know that most people don't know you. They're lost. But you have chosen us and set us apart. And so as we come into this space, calm our nerves and give us joy. Help us to dig into your word to make decisions and not look to the right or the left, but only to you. We thank you that greater is he who is in us than in the world. And God, help us to be an example to this lost world around us. Help us to stand up for your truth and your values, but also love your people. We pray these things in your precious and holy name. Everybody said, amen. Let's stand up. Love to see you guys back here at 2. It's going to be an absolute zoo in the parking lot. We're going to be dressed up and giving out candy to the community and loving them. But at this time, you can give offering on your way out, or you can give online if this is where you go to church, fund the ministry. But we're going to sing with one more worship song.